Good evening. I am Jitendra and I visited Nepal first time after the first week of the earthquake sent by my company, and later I went to Nepal sent by Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Trade, and then I worked in Nepal. Thank you, Jason, for raising quite a few concerns. I, being a Nepalese, hopefully I will be able to resolve a few of the concerns without scaring you. So basically, in Nepal, after this building assessment and other tasks, I was invited by United Nations to work on and develop, be a part of a team and work on post-disaster need assessment. And so I ended up working with World Bank and United Nations and other team members. And basically, I worked on developing post-disaster needs assessment, basically on housing and settlement. So the one of my tasks was to develop policy, how the reconstruction should be done, programming, planning, what should be the assistance package, and to develop a loss scenario. Of course, there are a lot of battles, how the reconstruction should be done, what materials should be used, and what should not be used. And then I briefly worked on cultural heritage sector. There are 23 sectors. But the housing was the biggest sector, maybe around 65%, 70% of the total budget will go there. So I am privileged to work on this. So basically, in my presentation, I will talk about what the policy was adopted, why particularly that policy was adopted, what was the philosophy and approach. And government has basically now accepted the policy, and the document has been published. And here is a cover page of the document, which I have brought. I have a hard copy. It is a, you can download from the website. So let's look at few statistics, what is required. Around 9,000 people were killed. Around 500,000 buildings have been destroyed, which needs reconstruction. Around 250,000 of buildings have been badly damaged, which need repair and strengthening. But the important thing is, most of the people, out of 9,000 people killed by buildings, which should have been the safest place to live. So when we are developing all the policy environment, what should be policy approach? So we are looking into these numbers. Of course, these numbers appear a bit biased based on my calibration, which we did in Nepal. But these are the numbers we used for whole policy environment. So let's look at few issues when we are developing a policy for whole earthquake affected area. So we are looking into these issues. So basically, this earthquake hit very hard rural and semi-urban area. Big urban areas practically escaped the earthquake. I mean practically. Of course, there was destruction, but they escaped. And so the issue, and most of the buildings in urban areas were badly damaged, whereas in rural and sub-rural areas or semi-urban areas, so badly destroyed. So immediately the issues are different. The reconstruction issues are different. The needs in rural and urban areas are very diverse. If you look at the building types, they are very different. So what should be the policy so we have earthquake resistant construction? Socio-cultural issues are very big issues to deal with because of the economics and all sort of thing. There is no finance, no insurance like here in crisis. Maybe I don't think even 1% of the buildings have been insured. Accessibility is a very big issue in Nepal. And I'll show you a few photographs. And affordability, of course. Per capita income in Nepal is less than $1,000. So you can imagine the economics, what we are talking about. And we also have to look at the how buildings are produced in Nepal before devising a policy or proposing a policy. There's a very big need of trained manpower. Even engineers are not trained for earthquake design, or they have not enough understanding of damage. And availability of land is really an issue. How we built in Nepal? Practically, engineers have no say in whole construction industry, other than in urban area, and I believe they have access to less than maybe 2-3% or 5% of the building in construction. So if I am to construct a house, I will invite a colleague, builder and tell him I need a 3-bedroom house, and he will design a building for me. I say, okay, buy 2 tons of steel, 50,000 bricks, 500 bags of cement. So that's all the design is. And he's my consultant, he's my advisor, he's my project manager, he's organizer. And he would do everything. So he is very pivotal in whole construction industry. But his role has never been recognized, unfortunately. And we have never empowered him to do something good. And they learn from their ancestors or their fathers or their masters. And predominant material in most of the earthquake affected area is locally available, stone or brick or mud type of thing. So of course there are the major issues. So here you can see the diversity of the building types. Here is a one building type in Kathmandu, is a very posh apartment building where apartment could easily cost you 300,000 New Zealand dollar, easily. Whereas at the other end, this house would cost maybe 1,000 US dollar or something like that. And this house is around 10 days walk from nearest motorable road. So if somebody thinks, cement is a good construction material, we should use cement. Cost of cement when you carry here could be easily $50 a bag. Whereas in roadhead side, in motorable area, the bag per a bag of cement will cost you maybe $10 or something like that. So it is easy saying we should use good construction material, cement or reinforcing bars, but it's a very, very difficult to implement. We must accept this fact. So safety doesn't come free. Similarly, the other traditional building made of mud, as Jason earlier showed one of the photographs. And then there is a mixed type of construction, because there's a rapid change in whole construction typology or building typology. So everybody aspires to have a reinforced concrete building, because that's a now status symbol. But of course, it costs a lot of money. So any policy should be able to address all these building types and how building is constructed and what resources are available, where the money will come from, and how we do the reconstruction. So let's look at the accessibility issue. I took this photograph from when I was flying to East Nepal, where I come from. So here you can see maybe 20 houses here, maybe one house here, one house here. So they are very scattered. And most of time, houses are constructed in the land which cannot be used for agriculture. Because the agricultural land is a far more important than the land we construct house in, because the food security is the most important thing in life, not the safety. So earthquake is a secondary thing, of course. So how you provide any support to these people, how they will carry some construction material from motorable road. So these are the major issues. So what should be the construction strategy? What we proposed and which has been accepted? Of course, still there is a lot of tussle going on and a lot of battle are being fought. But the current proposal, and that has been accepted by government, is the whole construction should be homeowner-driven construction. He should have right to choose material, size, shape, and architecture of the building. He should not be controlled. What resource he has, he should have right to do. But government should provide some assistance. But as part of the assistance, the house must be constructed earthquake resistant and should be other disaster resistant also. So the seismic resistance construction is the mandatory. Either he constructs a mud building or stone building. So that's the basic requirement. All the reconstruction should be assisted and inspected. And government should provide equitable assistance package. I'm not talking about equal, I'm talking about equitable. So the finance support could be different to different family based on their need or basic requirement. There could be a family led by a woman, because if woman is leading whole family, the family is a much more hardship. So that family should need bigger package than a family which has able-handed man. So, and then there comes planning issue. So it should be based on the risk. But the relocation of settlement is considered the least viable option. So should not be tried unless there is a real need, no relocation, no reclustering of communities. Despite they could be very scattered, because the reason is a family in mountain is here, somewhere there, he has house, he is there for certain reason. He is not just for there to be alone. Because his farm is there, he needs to look after the farm. You can't keep him for the name of safety, we can't take him 3 hours away. He has to walk every day in the morning 3 hours, and in the evening 3 hours return back to home. So we can't do these things. So that's the policy environment. Why honor-driven reconstruction? Because it will support whole village, whole rural sector for economic regeneration. People have lost their economics. So if they are doing themselves, the house owner can work as a laborer. Whole construction has to be managed by trained people, but still the house owner can work as laborer. So he saves money. So that will regenerate the rural economy. It will generate employment. And the best thing is the efficient use of the construction material, because the buildings have been collapsed. So this material can be recycled. So house owner can save money. And that will also save other, environmental disaster. Because if he starts throwing material, that will be other environmental disaster. It will also provide greater transparency in whole construction package. And the proposal is, when they construct house, there should be bank account of each beneficiary. And the government will give money in three tranches, not in one. So after each inspection, if the house has if the earthquake resistant feature and other feature has been incorporated, he will get second package. So there is a bigger transparency. Because it is a rural construction, so people will have, they will need less cash because they are working, they have their own construction material. So reconstruction will be much easier. And my observation or work in Pakistan, where I worked for 5.5 months or something like that, owner-driven reconstruction worked very well in rural sector. And is a much easier to mobilize if house owner has any saving. So he can construct as he likes. So the goal is not to construct barrack-like type construction in name of safer construction. We would like to see something like buildings or houses or settlement that reflects our identity, which recognizes us. So and this is the build houses and the culture people come to Nepal to see. So this is a whole drive, philosophical drive. We will need very large number of people, because around 3/4 million of the buildings has to be remediated, reconstructed or repaired and strengthened. So around maybe 20,000 people will be required. Carpenters, masons, master masons, and engineers. And one of the criteria to get assistance is, or anybody working in this reconstruction must have training on earthquake resistant construction. It could be 3 days training for engineers, or maybe it could be 7 days training for mason or carpenter, or could be 10 days training, which we are currently still working on. So how we train these people, and the whole reconstruction package program will go for 5 years. So we need 20,000 people for 5 years. How we train these big people? It's one of the massive challenges. How we support the families, especially woman-led families where there is no man to support reconstruction, elderly families or disabled families. So there are some packages identified in the program. Of course, this has to be worked out and detailed out, and how we protect these families. These are the major issues we raised and discussed on and worked on. So this needs to be looked at. There are other challenges. Of course, finance is a big challenge. Whatever government gives money would not be enough. So government is proposing, not finalized, as far as I know, will give soft loan in urban areas, but I'm not sure about how it will work in rural area, because the packages might not be enough for reconstruction of a good house. The needs are changing continuously. Because initially it was relief phase, now they are intermediate shelter, and now they need permanent house, and it will, this keeps changing because it's a social dimension. Accessibility is a very, very big issue. How you take construction material or any modern material, cement or reinforcement in these remote areas, where you have to walk, only means of transport is either carry on your back or mules. And it may take easily 3 days, 5 days, or something like that. How you manage that? Of course, whole construction package needs to be very transparent. Decentralized is essential, and our current system is most of power is now concentrated in Kathmandu. So that's one of the trouble. If we are to do owner-driven reconstruction, then timely support is required because they need money to proceed, but until these has been inspected, they can't get second tranche. So immediately there could be bottleneck. So bureaucratic approach would not work. But how it will work still has to be worked out. But in urban area, challenges are very, very different. My experience from Iran and Pakistan, where I worked after earthquake for reconstruction, what I found is urban rural reconstruction is much, much easier. Far easier than urban reconstruction. So there are land issues, building size issues, planning issues, heritage issues. So many issues are there. So these has to be resolved. So the strategy and policy environment for urban and rural area has to be different. Then there are issues with legal environment because there are some changes required in these Building Act, Engineering Council Act, and Apartment Act. Especially in Building Act, there is no policy requirement in Nepal for assessment and strengthening of building. So we have proposed these in our policy requirement, and hopefully government will make necessary amendments in the future. Thank you very much.